Well, good morning, good morning. And happy anniversary to Classen Boulevard Baptist Church. I'm going to ask that y'all would please stand and let's worship with Jesus. We know. Every day with Jesus.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me, and he's the one to live in for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day.
Now let's turn around and greet our brothers and sisters in Christ on this anniversary Sunday. Years. Yes. Oh, yeah. Let's say it one more time. Every day.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus. Oh, Jesus saves and keeps me, and he's the one I'm living.
Every
day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before.
Church said amen, and you may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome this anniversary day. This is Classen Boulevard Baptist Church anniversary, 72 years. Church began on June 1952. So thank you for being a part of that today. In a few minutes, we're going to see a video that shows some things that we've been doing in the last year. We had a busy year, so you'll enjoy that. Because we're having our anniversary, we're also having lunch. Dinner is provided, lunch is provided by the church, and the members brought desserts. So you're really going to be in, what do they say, hog heaven today? Lots of desserts. You'll enjoy that. So be sure and stay and enjoy lunch with us, and we'll continue to celebrate the day. Because we're going to do that, we're not going to have evening services. It'll take a while to do our visiting and get cleaned up, so we won't have services tonight. Everybody can go home and rest. So be sure and remember that. Now, because of your exceeding generosity, we exceeded our goal for the sidewalks out here. Thank you so much for all of you that were so generous in your giving. You'll appreciate that when it's done, and I think they're going to start on it this week. So thank you to all of you that did that. Now let's see that video.
This is a brief history since our last anniversary. We began our anniversary year in July by observing the Lord's Supper, a practice we continue every other month throughout the year. On Tuesday evenings, our men meet in Fellowship Hall for a meal and a Bible study at the Men's Bible Fellowship, led by June Carter. Wednesday evenings are set aside for prayer meetings, even on business meeting night. On one Sunday each month, following the evening service, we have a birthday fellowship with cake and ice cream for everyone. We ended July with a fifth Sunday movie night, eating snacks and goodies as we watched the movie Courageous, a true story of four officers who questioned their faith when tragedy struck close to home. The Imani's Children's Choir returned with many new faces on a Sunday evening in August for another energetic concert to raise awareness of the plight of orphans in Uganda. And before the summer was over, we welcomed two new members, Rose Smith and Cash Anthony. On September 17th, after our morning worship service, our members went down the street to celebrate St. Jude's 64th anniversary service and luncheon. October is Hunger Awareness Month. Every year, we collect food items for the food pantry at the Baptist Mission Center. But this year, we collected something they rarely receive but greatly need, saltine crackers. We collected boxes and boxes and boxes of crackers. The workers at the food pantry were most grateful for our gift. On Global Hunger Sunday, we distributed bread banks to our members. The banks were returned before Thanksgiving, and the money we collected was forwarded to Send Relief Hunger Funds. On October 8th, our members attended the Metro Baptist Network's Associational Annual Meeting at Cherokee Baptist Church. The association represents 170 Southern Baptist churches and missions in the Oklahoma City metro area, and it operates the Baptist Mission Center and Grace Rescue Mission in the Stockyards area. The following Saturday, we all showed up at the home of Raleigh and Janice Frost for an all-church picnic in their very large backyard. It was a little windy and cool outside that day, but the fellowship was sweet. Our fifth Sunday movie night in October featured the documentary, The Essential Church, revealing the difficulties of churches in the United States during COVID and their unwavering determination to exercise their constitutional rights and authority to remain open despite threats of arrest and heavy fines. In November, our members took a road trip to visit Reba's Place, a restaurant and gift shop owned by country music's own Reba McEntire in her hometown of Atoka. On the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we invited several local congregations to join us for our annual community Thanksgiving service. A few members from St. Jude Missionary came, and we were blessed by the message brought by their pastor, Reverend Bill Caldwell, and special music by their music director. Despite the very low attendance at the service, our offering totaled $198, which was donated to the Brittville Food Pantry. In early December, Carol Beck and her team decorated our auditorium in beautiful Christmas blues with silver and gold. The Christmas tree was inviting, and it became a favorite photo spot. December was full of events. The Klassen Singers, directed by June Carter, performed a Christmas mini cantata on the very first Sunday. We had a ladies' Christmas party and our annual all-church Christmas luncheon. We had an unusual off-site business meeting in December. Mr. Gaddy's Pizza had just opened on May Avenue, so we met there for dinner and discussion. On Friday, December 15th, our members attended a Christmas concert at Crossings Community Church that had congregational singing. The following week, Ray Venable drove the van, taking our group for a tour through Nichols Hills to see the beautiful Christmas lights, and they met a few unusual homeowners along the way. Charlotte Venable directed the Klassen Kids in bell ringing and introduced a new presentation of the meaning of Christmas. We had several rounds of snow and ice in January, and one service was canceled. But we observed the Sanctity of Human Life Sunday with Pastor Tim's thought-provoking sermon from Psalm 128, which began, "Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in obedience to Him." In February, we celebrated Valentine's Day with our annual banquet featuring June Carter. The following Sunday in mid-February gave us another day of ice and snow, so another service was canceled. In early March, Pastor Tim attended the Advance Evangelism Conference at St. John's Missionary Baptist Church, which featured several well-known pastors and preachers. Beginning Saturday, March 9th, and ending Wednesday, March 13th, several of our members joined with other Christians across the state and participated in the Bible Reading Marathon at the Oklahoma State Capitol. Volunteers signed up for certain times to read or just drop by, even in the middle of the night. The March movie night featured Sound of Freedom, the true story of children being rescued from sex traffickers. On Resurrection Sunday, we were blessed with special music from June Carter and the Klassen Singers, and we heard another powerful sermon from Pastor Tim entitled Three Stories. Passover was late on the calendar this year, so the actual first day of Passover, a few weeks after Easter, June Carter's friend, David Uten, came to us on a Sunday morning to explain the Passover Seder. We hope he will return next year to give us his presentation of the actual meal. Our church van was on the move again in April. Our members stopped for a Cracker Barrel breakfast in Oklahoma City, and then June Carter drove to the Oklahoma Aquarium in Jinx. We had lunch at a very nice restaurant overlooking the Arkansas River and then headed home. The following week, the van headed to Arkansas to have a picnic lunch at the side of the road and to witness a total solar eclipse. The group also got to experience the biggest traffic jam on the way home that any of us had ever seen. Ever. Our church celebrated Mother's Day and Father's Day with Sunday morning breakfast. We appreciate the time and effort by our members who prepare and serve on those two special days. For movie night in June, we watched the amazing true story of Dr. Ben Carson in his biographical movie, Gifted Hands, seeing how he rose from poverty and illiteracy into the most famous pediatric neurosurgeon of our time. We sent two messengers to the Southern Baptist Convention annual meeting in Indianapolis. Pastor Tim and Daniel Johnson returned with an interesting report of their adventures at the annual meeting and the Creation Museum and Ark Encounter in Kentucky on their way home. Charter member, deacon, Sunday school teacher, and friend, Buddy Johnson, passed away on June 18th. We are saddened at his passing, but rejoice when we remember the many, many years he served his church and his Lord. We end with a report of our mission giving since last June. For such a small congregation, we are blessed to be able to support missionaries around the world through the cooperative program and to support local mission efforts through our local association. Our Sunday evening offerings have greatly benefited the Hope Pregnancy Center and disaster relief efforts in Oklahoma. All of these offerings together total $30,550. For the record, our membership stands at 274. So, happy anniversary to the members of Classen Boulevard Baptist Church.
Let's bow our heads to our Lord. Heavenly Father, we stand here today, your humble servants, to present these gifts, these offerings to you, Lord. Let us be just a beautiful blessing to this neighborhood, good stewards to our fellow neighbors in this community. Amen. Thank you.
Amen, amen. Just a closer walk with thee, and it's so good to hear sisters playing together. Can we get an amen on that? Amen, amen. We're going to ask that you would please stand and call to worship right now. We're going to read Psalm 67, 3 through 5. Let us read that together. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you will judge the peoples with uprightness and guide the nations on the earth. Selah. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. And he has blessed our church 72 years now. We are truly blessed. Amen. Amen. And now we're going to let's celebrate Jesus, celebrate with music. Give God the praise. Let's sing.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Oh, yes. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
72 years, yes.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Oh, yeah.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
He has risen.
He is risen, he is risen, and he lives forevermore. He is risen, he is risen. Come on and celebrate
the resurrection.
The resurrection of the Lord.
Let's sing it again, come on.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Oh, yeah.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
He's worthy, yes, he is.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Almighty God.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
He is risen.
He is risen. He is risen, and he lives forevermore. He is risen, he is risen. Come on and celebrate the resurrection of the Lord.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Let us sing.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting, oh, leaning, and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting.
What have I to dread?
What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting, oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alone. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, and my song.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace,
when fears are
still, when striving cease. My comforter,
my all in all,
my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love
and righteousness,
and righteousness,
scorned
by the ones he came
to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied,
every sin
on him was laid.
Here in the death,
here in the death of Christ I live.
There
in the ground
his body lay.
Light of the world by darkness
then bursting.
Then bursting forth in glorious day,
up from the grave, he rose
again.
Yes,
and as he stands in victory, his curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and he is my bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life,
no fear in death,
no fear in death.
This is the power
of Christ in me.
From life's first cry to final breath,
Jesus commands
my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from
till he
returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Church said amen. And you may be seated. Amen. Amen, amen. That's beautiful. Then sings my soul, my Savior, to thee. Thank you, sister, both of you. At this time, we're going to have the class and singers to sing the song, The King is Coming.
The marketplace is empty. No more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent. No more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labor. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the King comes through the gate.
Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me.
Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed, broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children and the aged, hand in hand stand all aglow, who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow.
Oh, the King is coming, the King. I just heard the trumpet sounded, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me.
Well, I can hear the chariots rumble. I can see the marching throng. The flurry of God's trumpets spells the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolding. Heaven's grandstand, all the place. Heaven's choir, now assemble, start to sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me.
Praise God.
Praise God, he's coming for me.
I would like for us to turn together to Psalms 103. Psalms 103. If you will, stand with me for the reading of God's Word. Okay. The psalmist says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits, who pardons all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeemed your life from the pit, and who crowns you with loving kindness and compassion, and who satisfies your years with good things, so that your youth is renewed like eagles." Thank you. Let's have a word of prayer together, please. Father, we thank you for the privilege of being here. Thank you for the privilege of being able to give honor and glory and praise to your holy name. And we pray for your wisdom, for your guidance and direction. And I pray, dear Lord, that your name can be and will be adored, because it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. There was a man that walked up to a receptionist and in the doctor's office, and the receptionist said to him, "What are you here for?" And the man responded, "I've got shingles." The lady, being a very well-trained receptionist, reached under the counter, got a clipboard and said, "Please fill out the report, this medication form to the fullest, and then have a seat. We'll call you in just a moment." They took his information, and a nurse came in and said, "Sir, if you will, follow me." And she took him into one of those little rooms, had him have a seat, and took his blood pressure and temperature and said, "Put this gown on, take your clothes off, put this gown on. The doctor will be in to see you in just a moment." Man was getting somewhat frustrated, aggravated, and the doctor finally came in and said, "Sir, what are you here?" And he responded to the doctor, "I've got a load of shingles out here. Where do you want them?" There was a couple that had been on a trip. They were checking out of the motel, and the guy behind the counter said, "Sir, that'll be $450. "What? Why is it so high?" And the clerk said, "Well, for use of the pool, it was there." And the man responded, "We didn't get in the pool." The clerk said, "Well, it was there." And then there was the bellhop, and he carried your bags up to your room, and the man said, "But we carried our bags in ourselves." He was there for you. There is the hot tub. We didn't set foot in that hot tub, but it was there for you. $450. The man is somewhat agitated and aggravated, and he paused for a minute and he said to the clerk behind the counter, "Can I borrow your pen and that pad?" The man said, "Yeah, I guess." And he wrote something down and he said to the clerk, "And my bill for you is $500. The clerk said, "What do you mean $500? "Well, for hugging and kissing my wife, $500. I did no such thing. She was there for you. Now, some things get misunderstood, and some things get misapplied so many times in life. And so as we look at this Psalms together this morning, David says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Carolyn and my pastor, when we were, it was a few years ago, back in high school, he quoted this psalm, not every Sunday, but he quoted it quite often. And what a powerful message that Psalms has in it. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And what are you doing when you bless the Lord? I struggled with that a little bit. I thought, how in the world can anyone bless the Lord? But to say bless the Lord is to give honor and glory and praise to him. It's to compliment God for his goodness, for his kindness, for his generosity, for his love. There's all things that you can bless the Lord for. And we have, according to David, we need to praise the Lord. True praise comes from a heart of praise. It's not just something that is made up. It's not just something that you do trying to earn some brownie points with God. Okay? It is to be a delight. To delight God. Now, think about it for a minute. Parents, most everybody, not everybody, but most everybody here this morning has been a parent. Isn't it nice when your kids say, "Dad, you were so right. Thank you. Thank you for the upbringing. Thank you." And they mean it, and they're not just trying to get you to do something else for them, like I need. It's nice to hear that from your kids, and it's, I think, God desires to hear that from his children. And so he comes, and David is saying, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. I have so much to bless the Lord for. And so David starts out with a personal word of praise or blessing to God. It's not somebody else that needs to bless the Lord. David says, "It is me, Father. I am here to bless the Lord." Now, made me think of the song, "It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord." And I changed the words a little bit right after that. Standing in the need to bless you, Father. Now, that's not, doesn't make a good song, but it sure is the truth. I need to bless the Lord. And so he comes and he continues and he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name." Now, David is saying, because he uses that word soul, that is, soul is the idea of my total being. I am here to bless the Lord, because it's not just coming from an excuse or something I want to do. I'm not just going through empty words that mean nothing. I'm not brown-nosing God. Have you ever tried to brown-nose God? It's an impossible thing to do. He knows exactly what's in your mind and in your heart, in your soul. And so he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." And this word, my. My, I am the one that's doing this, not somebody else. Now, you may bless the Lord and others may bless the Lord, but I am here. I am the one that's going through this. I desire to bless the Lord. You know, the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please God. I can't do it unless I am trusting Him. I can't bless the Lord unless I have the intent of giving blessings and honor and praise to His holy name. And then in Mark chapter 12 and verse 29 and 30, Jesus says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." He is one. And then he continues and he says, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength." If I'm going to bless the Lord, I need to do it. I am the one who has the responsibility for it. Not everybody has that responsibility because not everybody has trusted Him. Not everybody acknowledges that He is God. I will bless the Lord with all of my heart. You need to ask, who's supposed to bless or praise God? Who has that responsibility? That call, bless the Lord, is a universal kind of call that is being said. David says it's him, but he says, in essence, everybody has that kind of responsibility. And so when you look at Psalms 103, he comes along and he says, "Bless the Lord," verse 20, "bless the Lord, you His angels, mighty in strength and power." They have to bless the Lord. They don't have as much reason to bless the Lord as you do. He didn't save them. He did not redeem them from sin. And so he comes along and in verse 21 he says, "Bless the Lord, all you hosts." That's all of the universe. Everything that God's created, he says, "Bless the Lord." Do you suppose you're included in that? Bless the Lord, and I dare say it includes us. I have to give a personal word of praise. God saved me from my sin. Ephesians 2:8-9. God has said that. Here is Paul, and he's writing, and he's saying, "I've been saved by grace through faith. That not of yourselves, lest anyone should boast." I have a reason to bless the Lord because He reached down and He touched me. He saved me. Now, question, what does God owe me? What does God owe you? Absolutely nothing. He did everything that is necessary for me to be saved. He has done all that I need to do, and He just comes and says, "I sent my Son to die on the cross for your sins." And if I accepted that, if I trust that, if I believe that, then I owe. Makes me think of that little children's song, I owe, it's off to work I go. No, it's I owe the Lord, and I owe Him everything that I have and everything that I am. I haven't mentioned the fact that he's gave me a family that I love. My kids aren't the best kids in the world. They're not the sharpest kids in the world, but they had enough sense one day to ask Jesus into their heart to be Savior and Lord. I've discovered that, you know, the more I live, the longer I live, I'm not as young as I used to be, Jim. You know, God has more patience than I can imagine. How many times has he had to be patient with me? And then I think about you, my church family. I am blessed to be a part of it. I've been blessed to get to be pastor here for a while. God has blessed me with so many different, think about it. I have health, I'm well, I'm not sick, I'm not in the hospital, I'm not laying on the slab at the funeral director's place of business. I've been blessed. I'm older than I've ever been. I've been blessed. And so have you. Some of you are just as old, and maybe one or two is older than I am. I've been blessed, and you have too. And you've got health. You have something to thank God for. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Satisfaction, he says. David said, I have satisfaction. Now, what gives you satisfaction? What gives you some satisfaction? I have some satisfaction when I get to eat peach pie, peach cobbler. It's one of my favorite desserts. I can eat steak. I've got the teeth to do it with, my own teeth. You may have false teeth, but you can still chew. Bless the Lord. I'm able to. He gives me satisfaction in life. Thank God for God. And then I remember the song, without him I could do nothing. Without him I would surely fail. But with God, thank God for all that I have and all that he has given to me. God is a wonderful God. Amen. David called on himself to worship the Lord and bless the Lord. There is peace when you have Christ as your Savior and your Lord. Jesus said in John 16:33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation. Now, have you ever had any tribulation? Carol has. She's had a car accident or two. That's tribulation, isn't it, Carol? Tribulation can be a lot of different things in a lot of different ways, without even being judgment or punishment because we're a Christian. And so God comes along and he says, Jesus finished that verse and said, but take courage, I have overcome the world. Jesus has overcome, and because of him, I can be an overcomer too, by faith in the Lord Jesus. David experienced the loving kindness of God. Now, he says in verse 3 and 4 and 5, he says, what do I have to be thankful for? Why do I bless the Lord? Because of who pardons all of your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. By the way, have you ever been sick?
Yes.
Have you ever had surgery? And, you know, who healed you? Who gave you the kind of body that you've got so that once you've had some surgery, it can heal itself? God does it. And so he pardons your iniquities. Iniquity. What is iniquity? That's another word for sin, but iniquity especially describes that which is twisted and perverted. Is there anything in your life that you've done that was twisted and perverted just a little bit? I dare say most of us have had some of that. And so he says God forgives all of your sins and all of your iniquities, who heals your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit. Have you ever been redeemed?
Amen.
Now, David must have been thinking about those times when the children of Israel were brought out of slavery and out of bondage, out of Egypt. That was a miracle that they could even leave Egypt. It's a wonder Pharaoh hadn't sent the army and killed them all with the first of the Ten Commandments, the first of the Ten Plagues. But God was with them. God was involved in all this, and God redeemed them out of bondage, and that's the idea of redemption anyway. Someone who's been caught up in the pit. Now, how many of you have ever been thrown in a pit? I was once, but I got out, obviously. It's the idea, but for these Jews, it was the idea that they were in a pit of bondage and they couldn't cause themselves to get out. And so God lifted them up out of the pit. He enabled them to get to the promised land. He lifted them up, set them into the promised land. Now, it was a 40-year wandering, but God did it. And they were able to be redeemed. Here is David and says, Lord, you've redeemed us. But how many of you have ever been in a dry place in your life? And things were just dry and dull and life wasn't worth living. Who got you out of that pit? The pit of dull, dry, boring, no hope. Jesus lifted me up. And he can lift you up too. If he can lift Joseph up, he can lift you up. And Jesus comes along, or David comes along, and he says, forget none of his benefits. Forget none of his, remember every good thing God's done for you. In other words, do you ever forget important things in your life? Raise your hand. Have you ever forgotten something important? You know, gentlemen, one of the important things we need to remember is our anniversary. May the 25th, 1968. Been married 56 years. It's only by the grace of God. God's grace is more than sufficient. You know, I've had some surgery in my life. That's sort of an important date to me. But for the life of me, I can't remember what year or what month. What's the matter with you? Can't you remember anything? Well, I try to. I've been trying to memorize some scripture, and I find that I have a hard time. I can remember the place, and I don't remember what the verse says. I might remember the gist of it, but to be able to quote it, I find that I struggle sometimes. And I'm thinking, what's the matter with you, Whit? Can't you do anything right? And sometimes I think God would like to say, Bob Witt, you know better than that. I heard that from my daddy, and I used it on myself more than once. We've been blessed with a good forgetter. I have, and I dare say a lot of us have been blessed with a good forgetter. We forget some things, and God says, don't forget any of your benefits. Now, why do we observe the Lord's Supper? We're supposed to remember what Christ has done. And if we forget, well, shame on us when we forget what God has done for us. What has God done for you? What has God done for you? Count your many blessings. Name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. And how do you remember some of the things that you're supposed to remember? Write it down. That's what my wife says. Write it down. Or tell it so many times that you can't possibly forget it. What has God done for you? Now's your chance. Now is your chance to bless the Lord. Anybody? Anybody, will you testify, bless the Lord? If you do, stand up. Say so. What about you?
I praise God for the good health that He's given. I have some things wrong, but I'm so much better shape.
Amen.
And I praise God for the ministry I've received here, the teachings and the beautiful stewards of Christ that help guide me to grow a closer relationship with God.
Excuse me. 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and sound mind. I get the impression some have this morning been overwhelmed with a sense of fear, and God didn't give it to you. God is a God who is able to do amazing things. We shouldn't clam up, we should open up and testify as to what God has done for us. Amen. If you will, turn to in your Bible to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Now, Sunday school lesson this morning was 2 Chronicles 7. We're looking a little bit after that. And I want to say to us, praising God is important. It's important. And you and I need to stop real often and remember what God has done. Now, the mercies and the grace that he has provided has been significant, wouldn't you say, in your own heart, in your own life? I said, he is a significant part of who we are, what we are, and how often has God given to us undeserved mercy. My goodness, if I stopped and I thought about it, of all the times that he could have condemned me, and yet he had mercy and grace. God owes us nothing. He doesn't owe me one thing. And I'm thankful for the fact that we can come into this building and be comfortable. After all, how hot does it get in the summer in Oklahoma? You been outside lately? If you have, you know how hot it gets. Have you been outside in the winter in Oklahoma and you are freezing to death with a cold north wind? But we have a place where we can come and be comfortable and worship God. I didn't have to walk to church today. Now, some people have to walk to church all day just to get to their church, and sometimes they get there and church service is already over because it takes so long. We have so much to be thankful for. I get to live in the United States of America. I'm blessed to live here. I could be living in one of those Muslim countries where it's against the law to even go to church, and if you do go to church, someone's going to beat the devil out of you. Maybe we need someone here that's going to beat the devil out of us so we won't act so devilish at times. I may disagree with some of the things that our presidents, plural, have done. I don't have to agree with them, but thankfully I live in a country where I can vote him out of office if I can. I may not vote him out of office because I'm not the only one who votes, but we have the privilege of voting. Not everybody has that privilege in this world today. I have the Holy Spirit of God who convicts me when I'm wrong. And I have the Holy Spirit of God who guides me to make good and right decisions when I ask him. The New King James Bible reads this way in Psalms 22 and verse 3. But you are holy, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. It sounds like God inhabits the praise of his people. And that means God's here. He's not just here on Sunday morning if two or three are gathered in his name. He's here in our hearts, in our souls, in our spirits. And so God blesses. Now you're thinking, is he ever going to get to 2 Chronicles chapter 20? Yes, I am. Amen. Turn back one page. Jehoshaphat was under attack. I'm giving you a little bit of history about this verse, starting in verse 3, chapter 20. And Jehoshaphat was afraid and turned his attention to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all of Judah. So Judah gathered together to seek the Lord, And they even came from all the cities of Judah to seek the Lord. Then Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court. And he said, O Lord, the God of our fathers, art thou not God in heaven? Art thou not the ruler over all the kingdoms of the nations? Power and might are in thy hand, so that no one can stand against me. What's he doing? He's praising God. He's standing there and he's declaring, you're the Lord God of heaven and earth. There's no one else like you. Right. Now, lots of nations have lots of different gods, little g, different gods. They can't do one blessed thing. They have to nail them up on the wall or nail them down so they'll not topple over. They are not a living God. But God is the Lord of all that there is. And so here is Jehoshaphat, and he's saying, hey, Lord, you're the living God. Excuse me, you're the living God of heaven and earth. You've created everything, and you're Almighty God. That's my God. Almighty God. He can do all things. And so praise declares our need and dependence on God. Praise, here's Jehoshaphat, he's been declaring to God that he is Almighty God, and he's saying, you're our God. We are depending on you because the enemy is coming against us, and there's more than just one army. There was three armies coming against them. And he said in verse 7, didst thou not, O God, O our God, drive out the inhabitants of the land before thy people Israel and give it to the descendants of Abraham, thy friend forever? And so he's saying, Lord, I'm remembering what you've done. I'm remembering who you are. I'm remembering what you have done for me. And who doesn't need to remember what God has done? And so we live in a time where people need to praise the Lord. They're not easy days to live. I mean, all sorts of things are happening and going on in our world, and it looks like our world is out of control, but God is still, he's still in control. Amen. And so, thank God we have such a God. We live in a time when there's so many negative things happening. World history says there's lots of, you listen to the evening news and it's discouraging. You listen to what is happening at work and they're closing places down, and that's discouraging, especially when it's your job. And kids and grandkids have problems, and they start coming home and they say, Mom, Dad, this is what happened at school today. And it's discouraging. And we can talk ourselves out of blessing and praising God. It's easy to happen. It's easy to do. And so he comes and he reminds us that we need to be able to praise him even when things are hard. Now, I dare say that when Jehoshaphat called the nation of Israel to a time of prayer, things were hard. They were scared. They were scared to death. And you keep reading down through there and you read on to verse 12. And he says, "Oh, our God, will you not judge them? For we are powerless before this great multitude who are coming against us." And we don't know what to do. Have you ever been in a place where you just, "Lord, what do I do now? I don't know what I need to do. I don't know what I should do." Yeah. Let me make a suggestion. Bless the Lord. Remember who God is. Remember what God has done. And then, verse 14, "And then in the midst of the assembly, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, the Levite, the sons of Asaph." And I'm not sure if I'm saying those right or not, but it's close. Verse 15, "And he said, Listen, all of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem and King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you, do not fear or be dismayed because of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but it's God's." Woo! Don't you think they started jumping up and down and saying, "Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. The battle is not really yours, it's God's." How many times has God said, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I don't know what to do." And I was laying in bed last night and I was thinking about that country and western song, "We rush and rush and to get things done, and I don't know why. Why am I in such a hurry?" God is never late. I don't have to, you know, I get in a hurry and I get in a hurry and I feel like I've got to do this and I've got to do that, and I let those things play in my mind until I don't have time to think about God. See, we get in such a hurry and we forget that God is still in charge, and all I need to do is put God first in my heart and in my life. So here is Jehoshaphat, and he's saying to the nation of Israel, and we need to say to ourselves as well, we have a God that hears us and answers our prayers. I may not like what's happening in the world, but I'm not the one who's in charge of it. Lots of people, lots of leaders, lots of men and women who make some decisions for their countries and for their nation, they have quite often don't even know who God is. The Muslim countries of the world, I'm not born there. I don't live there. And if I did, the chances of me becoming a Christian would be slim and none. Now, I've been talking sort of soft. We need to wake up and realize who God is and allow Him to be God every day. There's problems that happen all the time, but God is in charge. He can take care of them. And so here is Jehoshaphat, and Jesus would remind you and me. Luke 1:37. I'm skipping about half my sermon because it's getting late. Jesus said, "For nothing is impossible with God." That's a relief, isn't it? Yeah. And Jeremiah has something very similar to say, if I can get it picked out, "Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made heaven and earth, and by thy great power and by your outstretched arm, nothing is impossible with God." He says, God says it twice. How many times does he need to tell us that before we start practicing it? Nothing is impossible. Glory, hallelujah! Nothing is impossible with God. And so here is Jehoshaphat and the children of Israel. God said, you don't have to fight. You don't have to worry about it. The battle is not yours. The battle is mine. And then he says in verse 17, you need not fight in this battle. Station yourselves and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. Now, Jehoshaphat sought God. God's answered him, and God has said to him, stand still. Psalms 46:10 says, stand still. Don't worry about it. Stand still and see what God can do. See what God can do. And so here is the Lord, and he's saying, I am the Lord of all nations. When you're going into war, isn't it nice to know that God is the God of all nations, and he's going to make sure that the right side wins? That makes me feel good all over. And so you need not fight, but station yourselves. And he says, line up like you're going into battle. Get in position, because you've got this war. And God says, and verse 20, and they rose early in the morning, and they went out into the wilderness. And when they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me, O Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem. Put your trust in the Lord your God. We need a president that will do that for us. And he continues there, and he will, and you will be established. Put your trust in the prophets and succeed. And then in verse 21, he says, and when he had consulted the people, he appointed those who sang to the Lord, June and the class and choir and all of us, those who had sang to the Lord and praised him in holy attire. They went out before the army. The singers went out in front of the army. How many times do you see an army with singers in front of them? June, would you be excited to be in front of that army? Says something about our confidence, doesn't it? And when they began singing and praising the Lord set ambushes against the sons of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who had come against Jerusalem, so that they were routed. Now, praise God is an act of faith. When you praise God, you're acting in faith. I believe, Lord, you're going to do something. I don't know what you're going to do, but I believe you're going to do it. And then they begin to act in obedience, and they gave praise. They sang praises to God. They got out there, and they were doing what God had told them to do. Praise released the power of God. Somehow, think about it. Do you want the power of God? Praise helps to release that power, remembering who God is and what God has done. And so when Judah came to the lookout of the wilderness, they looked towards the multitude, and behold, they were corpses lying on the ground, and no one had escaped. Wow. Look what God has done. And when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take their spoil, they found much among them, including goods, garments, valuable things, and they took for themselves more than they could carry. And they were 3 days taking the spoils because there was so much. Can you imagine 3 days worth of just collecting stuff to take home? And every, verse 27, and every man of Judah and Jerusalem returned with Jehoshaphat at their head, returning to Jerusalem with joy, for the Lord had made them to rejoice over their enemies. Praise imparts joy to the Lord, but that joy is going to be shared with the people. Now, think about it. I don't know about you, but when I have the privilege of getting to be in God's house and I see friends that I haven't seen for a while, good reason. They've been ill, they've been sick, and I get to see them again, that makes me want to rejoice. Yes. And when I see them, I want to let them know, I'm so glad you're here. You've made my day. You picked me up. You encouraged me. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Yes, sir.
I wish there were more here. There's some friends I miss. But I'm blessed when I get to see them, especially when I get to see them in God's house. Praise the Lord. You know, I don't know. Brother Tim, I have no idea if we got more or less here for our morning worship. I think we've got more, but I'm not sure. But I praise the Lord for the fact that you came and you made the effort. Some people aren't willing to make the effort. And I praise the Lord because you did. And it encourages me, and I hope it encourages you. God is good. So praise the Lord and bless Him. Let's have a word of prayer together, please. Heavenly Father, I just want to bless your holy name. Thank you for what you've done for me. Thank you for what you've done for this church, 72 years. It's no record, Father, I know, but I'm blessed just to get to be a part of it. Thank you. Bless you. Father, I just want to say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Father, I pray that if someone needs to respond this morning because they can't bless the Lord because they don't know you, that you'd lead them. Maybe someone here who is a part of the church and has been saved, but they've allowed things to get in the way. Father, speak to them. And thank you for speaking to us, because it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand together, please. If you need to respond in some way, you come. Brother Tim's going to be here at the front, and he will help you with whatever way that you may need to respond to the Lord. You come as we sing.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name.
Are we still singing? I don't know. But we ought to say, bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Amen.
That is within me. Truly, he is deserving of our praise. The scripture says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And we've been encouraged to say so on this day. Well, our day isn't over. We got some good food waiting on us. And so I'm going to go ahead and close this with a word of prayer of Thanksgiving. And we can just go on into the back to the fellowship hall and just get after it and continue our fellowship with one another. So let's close with a word of prayer. Our Father, we do thank you for your goodness to us. You're so kind in providing us so many things. Forgive us for our ungratefulness and for not saying so. We thank you for the food that you have provided. We thank you for your church that you redeemed with your own blood, the pillar and foundation of truth. And we thank you for this local assembly. And Lord, might we stand for your truth for years to come. We love you and we thank you. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen.